طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين إن شاء الله my dear respected brothers and sisters will resume إن شاء الله our class which is some narrations explaining some narrations some ahadith in the chapter of Salah from the book Bulugh al-Maram, Kitab Bulugh al-Maram. And today, inshallah, we'll discuss very important point that many people, they ask about, and they always, there's a lot of argument about it, which is the question that many people ask, which one should we start with when we go down to sujood? Should we go, you know, to sujood, starting with our knees or our hands? And inshallah today we'll discuss it in detail and mention the narrations which relate to this subject. So if you go to the first narration that we'll discuss, it is the hadith which was narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. قال He narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when one of you prostrates, he should not kneel down in his prayer as a camel does. As a camel does. Put his knees down before his hands. He must put his hands first on the ground before he puts his knees down. This related by the three imams. And the writer or the author of the book of Bulugh al-Maram comment, it is stronger than the hadith narrated by Wa'il ibn Hujr. And inshallah we'll talk about this hadith. Hadith Wa'il was not mentioned here. But the hadith of Wa'il, in fact, said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he prostrate, he will put his knees before his hands. So now we have two hadith. One of them, people understand that when the person is praying and he go down to prostrate, he should start putting his hands first. This is one view. The other view said that according to this hadith, then the one when he prostrate, he should go down on his knees first. It's interesting that all the ulama who have these two different views, they use the same, almost the same hadith as evidence. But the difference is what? The difference in understanding this hadith. Each group explained it differently. So some of them, they said, going down, the camel, when he go down, he go on his knees, and his knees is in his hands. Other, they said, no. The hadith said, don't go down like camels when he put his hands first. So this argument between the two groups may confuse some people, and they don't know to which one they should follow. In fact, from this we need to mention that scholars, as we said, have differed about which situation. But according to the Hanafi, the Shafi'i, and one view narrated by Imam Ahmad, that's mean the Imam Ahmad or the Hanbali, they have two views. Even in the same madhab, they have two views. One of them is go with the Hanafi and Shafi'i, which said that the person who is praying should go down on his knees first. This is the first view. Then he put his hands. And Imam al-Tirmidhi mentioned that this is the view of the majority of the ulama. The majority of the ulama. In fact, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and also his student Ibn al-Qayyim from present time, Shaykh bin Baz and Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, all of them, they go with the view that when the person prostrate or, you know, move from standing position, going down to prostrate, he should put his knees on the ground first and then he should put his hand. And when he come up, he take his hands first and then he take his knees. So this is the view which Imam Tirmidhi said, this is the view of the majority of the ulama. But there are other view which said that one should put his hands first. But before we come to this, we ask why the majority of, or most people, they said that putting the knees first. This depending on the hadith that we mentioned there, which is the hadith Wa'il. Because Wa'il ibn Hajr radiallahu anhu, he said, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he did sujood, he putting his knees first before the hands. And when he got up, he raised his hands before his knees. So here we have another narration which support the view that when the person pray or prostrate, he should put his knees first. And this mentioned or reported by Abu Dawud, At-Tirmidhi, An-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, and Ad-Darqutni. But there's some ulama, they have some reservation regarding this hadith, because there was one narrator there who they are not agree about him, so they said the isnad is ضعيف. So Imam al-Albani rahimahullah, Imam al-Albani, he classify this hadith that it is ضعيف. This is why Imam al-Albani rahimahullah is of the view of this group of ulama who said that one, when he go down, he should, for prostration, he should put his hands first and then his knees. Now we conclude from this, my dear brothers and sisters, that this if the person, you know, went down with his hands or with his knees, both are correct. This will not invalidate the salah. We are here discussing which one is the best or more authentic sunnah to be followed. But the ulama said, in general, the person should look, depend on the person who's praying. If he is strong enough, young enough, and he is able to go down with his knees first, then this will be preferred, because the majority of the ulama, and also supported by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and others, that he go first with his knees. But if the person have some problem with his knees, or it is difficult for him to go down his knees, he's an old person or somebody who have some problems with his knees, and he went down in prostration, starting with his hands, and then when he get up, he depend on his hands, there's no problem with this. So both are, inshallah, okay regarding this. If you go to the explanation of our Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, he said, he tried to explain the word, لا يبرك كما يبرك البعير. should not go down like the camel. And he explained this by saying, يعني لا يضع يديه قبل ركبته. Then the understanding of Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen that he should not put his hands before his knees. Because he said, the camel, when he go down, he put his hands before his knees. You know if you see any camel, when he go down to sit, he go in the front. So he put his hand and then he relax on his back. But the problem is the other part of the hadith, it said, وَلْيَضَعُ يَدَيْهِ قَبْلَ رُكْبَتَيْهِ. But he should put his hands, palms, before his hand, before his knees. So here, it's like there is contradiction if we understand that. If we resemble the ba'ir, which is the camel, that means the person should put his hands. And then the other part of the hadith, the narration, it said he should put his hands. So the ulama said, they try to explain this by saying there is iqlab, or there is something wrong with the one who reported this hadith, that he mixed about this. So he said, there is hadith mutanakil. That means the first part is contradict the second part of the hadith. So they said the narrator is a human being and he may make a mistake. And he said, the Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, according to the book that we explained, he said, was-sawab, that the second part should be corrected. Instead of saying he should put his hands before his knees, he should say, وليضع ركبتيه قبل يديه. Then he should put his knees before his two hands. If it's the statement like this, there is no contradiction between the first part of the hadith and the second part. This is the explanation which was mentioned here. Anyway, as we said, depends on the person. If the person is able to go down first on his knees, then that will be more preferable, because as we said, the majority of the ulama and the explanation of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and as we just explained by Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, this is the more or the majority of the ulama go with. But if the person, it's difficult for him to go down to sujood with his knees, then it's okay to start with his hand. Some of the benefit of this hadith, that we were prohibited from resembling animals when we are doing our salah. This is one of the example. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in different hadith narrations, always when he is telling us about salah or how to do certain position, he said, don't do like the lion, don't do like the dog, don't do like the camel. So for example here, when he said, don't go down like the camel. Another hadith, لا يفترش أحدكم لرعيه افتراش السبع. When one go in sujood, he should not put both hands, the whole arms, both arms on the ground, same like a lion or like wild animal. Another hadith said, when the person making sujood, he should not do it like the crow. The crow, when you go like very quickly, he moving, to pick something. So in other hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, when one sit, he should not sit like a dog. So here, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام using a different way to explain to the people the position by compare it to the position of some of the animals that people know. So don't do like this, don't do like this. And in this way, people, they may understand maybe more than just word don't do this, but give an example for this. Now, I hope this is clear, but if there's any of the brothers or sisters that have any question regarding this, inshallah, we can come back to this hadith. The second hadith, which was reported by Ibn Umar, radiallahu an. And here, brothers who are following me with in the Zoom, I just would like to mention that I already posted the hadith or the narration that we are explaining in the Facebook, so you can go back to it, or you can check your book to follow this. Now, the next hadith, which was narrated by Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه, he said, whenever the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم sat for tashahhud, he would place his left hand on his left knee, the left hand on the left knee, and his right hand on his right knee, on the knee, both in the knee, and he would form a ring like 53, because the 5 in Arabic is like this, and this 3. Okay, so when the Prophet ﷺ sitting, and then he will have his hand pointing like this, pointing with the index in the right hand. So, and point with his index finger, the right hand is held close, in this case with the thumb touching the side of the index finger, which alone is extended to point with it, so like this. So he's with the index. Now, this hadith related by Imam Muslim. In other version, Imam Muslim said, and he would close his hand, clench his finger. This is another way. And point with his index like this. And he put it in his right knees. Put it on his right knees. So, to explain, this is the way of tashahhud. Now, do we do in this this in the first tashahhud or the second tashahhud? This is in any time when the person sitting for the tashahhud, he use this way and when he is sitting. Now the question that many people ask, okay, when does the person should mention with his index? Is it all the time like this? I mean, he point with his index all the time, as-sababa, or he move it all the time, or he keep it and move it sometime, because there are different views regarding this matter also. So here we have two ways, as the Shaykh mentioned here. The first one, يحلق الإبهام مع الوسطى. That's mean this one. And keep this. The Ibham, this is the Ibham, the thumb. And this is the wasta, the middle finger. So he hold it like this. This is the first one. And then leave the index, we're pointing with the index. So he said, when he mentioned the name of Allah, he will move it. Like, for example, saying, at-Tahiyyatu lillahi. So he will raise the index. Was-salawatu wa-t-tayyibatu. As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu. Wa rahmatullahi. So he said, explanation, whenever he talk, he will raise up when he mentioned the name of Allah. Naam. So from this we know that this is the way of the sunnah when we are in the sitting position for at-tahiyyat. We learn from this also, as the Shaykh said here, this is only for tashahhud, not between the small, the very light pose between the two sajda, between the two prostration. Because some people, you know, when they sit between two prostration, we don't do this. Okay? Just sit for a moment and then go back to say Rabbi Ghafirli and then go back to. So this only done at the time of at-tashahhud. Na'am. Na'am. Because the hadith said, إِذَا قَعَدَ لَتَّشَهُدُ. When the Prophet ﷺ said for التشهد, he didn't mention that whenever he said. No. I think this is very clear about this hadith. Let's go to the next hadith, inshallah. The next hadith explains the words of at-tahiyyat. وعن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه. This is the hadith. I will read just the translation of the hadith to save the time. عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه narrated that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم turned around to us and said, when any of you prays and sits for the final tashahhud, then he should say, all greeting of humility are for Allah. And all of us, we know this. At-tahiyyatu lillahi was-salawatu wa-t-tayyibat. For Allah. And all prayers and good deeds are for Allah. Peace upon you. Assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi. O Prophet, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, peace be upon us, assalamu alayna, and upon all righteous slaves of Allah, wa ala ibadillahi salihin. I bear witness that none is worthy to be worshipped except Allah Azza wa Jal, and I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his slave and his messenger. Then he may choose, then, that's mean after saying at-tahiyyat, then he may choose whatever supplication you like best and recite. This hadith is agreed upon. Now, this the first tashahhud. But we know that if the person sitting for the final tashahhud, we add as-salatu al-Ibrahimi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Ali Muhammad to the end of that hadith. Na'am. Now let's go to that explanation. النسائي, الإمام النسائي said, كنا نقول قبل أن يفرض علينا التشهد. That we used to say this before we learn التشهد. نعم. Now let's explain this hadith according to the Shaykh bin Uthaymeen. He said, At-tahiyyatu lillahi. At-tahiyyatu. Al. With al, that means all types of greeting. Because tahiyyat means greeting. Okay? So, at-tahiyyatu, that means all types of good greetings. Like praising Allah, honoring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believing the greatness of Allah, all this consider of at-tahiyyat. Lillahi, this only for Allah. That means he is the only one who deserves this. Naam. Was-salawatu. As-salawat means any prayer. Because the word of salah in Arabic, in fact, it means the salah is a dua. As-salah Ad-du'a, this is the linguistic meaning for salah. Salah, du'a. That means supplication, invocation. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said to the Prophet فَصَلِّ إِنَّ صَلَاتَكَ سَكَنٌ لَهُمْ. That's pray for them. That means make du'a for them. So the word salah in general, in the Arabic language, means ad-du'a. So all the du'a should be, you know, go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also including the any acts of ibadah. Some ulama, they said that also include all acts of ibadah should be go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am. The ayah which I mentioned, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ. This in Surah At-Tawbah, verse 103. وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ. That's make dua for them. Our Prophet of Allah make dua for them. نعم. الطَّيِّبَاتُ. What's the meaning of طَيِّب? طَيِّب means good. Any good thing. So good, طَيِّب. خَبِيث, bad. So when we talk about at-tayyib wa at-tayyibat, always refers to good things. As is mentioned in the Quran, يُحِلُّ لَهُمْ at-tayyibat, to make permissible for them all type of good things when we talk about food. وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمْ الْخَبَائِثِ. So we have tayyibat, the opposite is khaba'ith. وَالطَّيِّب singular. So any good things will be considered as tayyib. And this tayyib is one which belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. As the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. إِنَّ اللَّهَ, Allah is tayyib. لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. Does not accept what is good. So Allah is good and accept only the good things. So what do we mean by at-tayyibat or Allah tayyib? That means whatever Allah is do is good. Even sometimes some people, they think about it that what happened for them is not good, and since Allah ordained it, so how can we say this whatever come from Allah good? Yes, in the planning of Allah Azza wa Jal, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plan and do is always good. But for the view of the people, maybe they think about it different way. And this is why the Quran emphasized the fact that we should not just think about any things from what has appeared for us. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, what? وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. You may dislike something, but there is good for you in that thing. وعسى أن تحب شيئا وهو شر لكم. And you may like something, but it's not good for you. So whatever comes from Allah is good. For us, as a human being, and we think about it, that or view it, that it's not good, because we don't know the wisdom behind it. You don't know. Maybe some, you know, a person, he gets sick till almost he died. Maybe this sickness will return to Allah and repent and later on be a righteous person. And we know from many stories, from those brothers or sisters who come to Islam, some of them, they come and thought about Islam and thought about Allah Azza wa Jal when they were, you know, that they went through a very, you know, serious sickness. One example of them, Yusuf Islam, Cat Stevens, when if you read or hear about his story, he was almost dying of sickness. And when he was isolated himself and he recited the Quran, thought about Allah Azza wa Jal, thought about the deen, about the religion, about the faith. So this was a reason for him to come to Islam. So whatever Allah Azza wa Jal do, always good. This is why we call him Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is good. Whatever come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always good, if we didn't know the point or the wisdom behind it. And then it said, As-salamu alayka. Now, As-salamu alayka, peace upon you. And this is what we call it when you're addressing the person. This is what we call it, second person. You are talking to a second person. So if you want to talk about somebody or third person that is not there, you will say, As-salamu alayhi. So why should we say, As-salamu alaykum, ayyuhan nabi? And then maybe some people, they think this is maybe at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now people, they should say, As-salamu alayhi. And that's wrong. Always, whenever their dua or supplication or any narration that we learn it from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we say it as it is, without any change. And this is why, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi. He mentioned, O Prophet. So it's not right to say, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan rasul. Peace upon you, O Messenger. No. Why? Because the hadith taught us to say, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi. Peace upon you, peace upon you, O Prophet. O Prophet. So nobody will come and say, why I don't say, you know, it's better to say messenger, because the messenger is higher than prophethood. So we said, As-salamu alayka ayyuha ar-rasul. He said, we should stick to the hadith which we learn when our from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is also in the dua. One time the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam was teaching one of the Sahaba that when he go to bed, he say certain dua. And in this dua he said, Amantu bi kitabika alladhi anzalt wa nabiyyuka alladhi arsalt. O Allah, I believed in the book that you revealed and the prophet that you sent. So the Sahabi, while was he's taking this word from the Prophet, he said, Wa rasuluka alladhi arsalt. Then the Prophet ﷺ corrected him and he said, Wa nabiyyuka alladhi arsalt. And your prophet that you sent. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, emphasize that we should stick to the words that we learn from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Even one word. So if we think about it now, we said, how come I said, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi? As-salamu alayka, I deal with it as a second person, somebody that I talk to him. We said, we take it as it is, because the Prophet ﷺ taught his companions and all the ulama and all the Muslims throughout history, they do it this way. So we should not say, some people will come and use their mind and they will say, As-salamu alayhi, As-salamu ala al-Nabi. No, As-salamu alayka ayyuha al-Nabi. Na'am. As addressing him. Na'am. Some people, they ask sometimes, what's the difference between al-Nabi and al-Rasul? Every messenger is a prophet. كل رسول نبي. But not every prophet is a messenger. The first stage is prophethood. There's prophet, many prophets. That's even the prophets, the number of prophets that Allah Azza wa Jal sent, more than 24,000 prophets throughout history. The messenger is only about 3,000. So there's difference between the prophet and the messenger. But every messenger, before he become messenger, he's prophet. And this is why our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he nubbi'a bi'iqra. He was told, informed that he is a prophet when Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed to him, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. And then when he said, when he commanded him to call people, then he become messenger. But he's a messenger of Allah from the beginning. But this is a stage. It's a matter of stage. So every messenger is a prophet, but not every prophet is a messenger. I hope this will be clear. This is why uh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Ya ayyuha ar-rasulu, balligh ma unzil ilayka min rabbik. O messenger, balligh, extend or convey the message, what was revealed to you from your Lord. So this is the meaning of the messenger, the one who carried message. Some ulama, they said, the messenger is the one who come, or he was commanded to call people. And the prophet, the one who come to the people and follow the law or the message of previous messenger, like Anbiya Bani Israel, many prophets among the children of Israel. All these prophets, in fact, they were applying the Torah, which was revealed to Musa alayhi as-salam. Naam. طيب, when he said as-salam, what does it mean? As-salam, al-du'a'u lahu bis-salama. When he said as-salam, that means you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for one that may Allah azza wa jal keep him safe. This is the meaning of as-salam. Now, some people will say, okay, isn't the Prophet ﷺ was already, he was protected from anything that may hurt him? So why should we say as-salam? The answer for this, as the Shaykh said, this is the dua of all prophets at the Day of Judgment. You know, at the Day of Judgment, all the messengers of Allah, when they are in the bath, or you see, in the sirat, they would say, Allahumma sallim, sallim. Oh Allah, keep us safe and keep our followers safe from this sirat. Other point the Shaykh mentioned, he said, also this dua that may Allah Azza wa Jal protect the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam even after his death, so nobody will attack his grave, as it's happened one time. It's mentioned one time in history that there are some of the enemies of Islam, they try to dig down and then get the body of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And it was mentioned in the history that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show the leader or the ruler at that time in his sleep as a vision or as a dream about there are two people, they are trying to come, you know, and try to dig down to get the body of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And it was mentioned, this story is very famous, the Shaykh bin Athameen mentioned this, and he said the Khalifa, or the Khalifa at that time, he saw many times, or more than one time, that there are two men, they are trying to dig in and get to take the body of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So he went to Medina, and then he asked that he will call and invite all people in Medina to a meeting or gather. So everybody come, but he didn't see, try to see the person that the two people that he saw in his dream. And then he asked, is there anybody left? So they said there are two strange people, travelers. They just come to Medina and they are living beside the masjid. And then when he commanded them to bring them, these two people, and he saw their faces and he recognized them. And then when they went to their home, they checked. They found they were digging like a channel or trench inside under the ground to reach the grave of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So the point here is that when said As-salamu alayka, that it's always dua that Allah عز وجل protect and preserve the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. قال ورحمة الله. الرحمة the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this to confirm. وبركاته and a blessing. That's mean from the word baraka, which is too much. This is why they call the place of water, you know, whenever there is a lot of water in one place, they said birkat ma or birka, baraka, because the place where all water will gather. Assalamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi as-salihin. So we start with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before ourselves. So we say assalamu alayka ayyuha an-nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Then we turn to ourselves. Why? Because we should always remember that we should put the love of the Prophet alayhi as-salatu was-salam ahead before our love for our children, our parents, our family, our people, even ourselves. Even ourselves. Why? This is the right order. The love of Allah Azza wa Jal, the love of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and then you love whomever you want. But this is the right order. So we should not love our children more than the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or our wife, or even ourselves. As mentioned in the hadith, when Umar radiallahu anhu said one time to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, O Prophet of Allah, I love you more than anybody else except myself. The Prophet alayhi salam said, no, O Umar, but even before yourself. Then Umar radiallahu anhu said, I love you, O Prophet of Allah, more than even myself. And this is the right way. So always we start with Assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi, to teach us that our love to the Prophet ﷺ come before ourselves. And then we call for ourselves and also make invocation for ourselves and for others. And this is why always, whenever when we said ibadullah as-salihin, all the righteous slave of Allah, this include whom? This include the angels, the believers among jinn or people, the believers of previous nation. So this is very general statement, will include every righteous slave of Allah, we make prayer for him. Now. I think because okay, let's finish this, because I don't want to, I would like to leave some time for your question, Dennis. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. Now, the word of Shahada, we all know it. But here we say it with the tongue, believing in the heart. So, the testimony of faith, if it was only word without believing the heart, then it will not be considered as shahada. But it's saying, this is why the munafiqeen, the hypocrites, they may say this word. And this was mentioned in Surah Al-Munafiqun. Ya ayyuha an-nabi, idha ja'aka al-munafiqun qalu nashhadu innaka rasulullah. When the hypocrite come to you, they said, we testify that you are the messenger of Allah. What was the answer? Allah yashhad innaka rasulullah. And Allah testify that you are his messenger. والله يشهد أن المنافقين لكاذبون. But those hypocrites, when they say that, we testify that you are the messenger of Allah, they are lying. Why they are lying? Because they say something with their tongue, but it's not in their heart. So when we say this shahada, we say it with our tongue. At the same time, we know and believe in every word of this. And there's explanation for the meaning of the shahada, and you know the shurut, conditions of la ilaha illallah, and muqtadayat, the requirement for la ilaha illallah. This is another subject maybe we studied in aqidah. Na'am. وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ ورسوله. Now, why we said عبده before رسوله? Because the stage of عبودية is more higher than the stage of being messenger. What's mean عبودية? عبودية does mean to be feel that you are belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are slave of Allah Azza wa Jal. You are owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are will return to Allah Azza wa Jal. This is the ubud. This is why this stage is more higher than being a messenger. Where do we get this from? We get in the Quran. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always called the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, O Prophet. Ya ayyuhan rasulu, O Messenger. Always call him with this. Never ever the Quran addressed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his name, Ya Muhammad. Never. Always in the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal call other prophets, Ya Ibrahim, قد صدقت الرؤيا. Ya Musa, Ya Isa, أأنت قلت للناس. Call other prophets by their name. But when it's come to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran always addresses him with his title. Say, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, Ya ayyuhan rasul. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention his favor in his Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, he mentioned him as a slave. Like for example, in al-Isra, you know Allah, one of the great favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he took him in the night journey to Al-Quds, and then he sent him to the seven heavens. What did Allah Azza wa Jal say about this in Surah Al-Isra? Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi. Praise be to Allah. Praise be to the one who took his slave, he didn't say his messenger, his slave. And also in the maqam of da'wah, وَلَمَّا قَامَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ يَدْعُوهُ, when slave of Allah start da'wah. So as general we talk here, so to say عَبْدِلَّهِ, this is honor for anybody. The best honor for you or for me, for any of the creation of Allah, that he always know, believe, feel, realize that he is a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because slavery for, we know that people, they are very sensitive for the word slavery. They say slave. Why? Because people, people link it to what people did when they enslave other people, like what's happened in the past. No matter, that's humiliation for a human being. This is why in Islam always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advised us, commanded us, even in certain kafarat to get forgiven for a certain sin, one should free a slave. Alhamdulillah, there's no slave these days. But this is the negative concept. But for to be slave to Allah, this is an honor that Allah accept you as slave for him. Now. And then he said, ثُمَّ يَتَخَيَّرْ مِنَ الدُّعَاءِ. Then after this, he make whatever dua. Inshallah, we'll continue this next week in more, if there's any question regarding this, please don't hesitate to ask. جزاكم الله خير وبارك الله فيكم جميعا. نعم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الشيخ.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Regarding at-Tahiyyatu, is there any other more than one form or the only one form, Shaykh?
There are more than one form. There are more than one form of at-Tahiyyat, more narrations. And this, as we mentioned before, in the Salah, Subhanallah, the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam taught us different forms and different positions. Like for example, in the start of the Salah, Dua al-Istiftah, there is different forms. You remember this. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, wa tabaraka ismuk, wa ta'ala jadduk. This is one. and then the other one, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمْحَيَا وَمَاتِي, to the end. And then, اللَّهُمَّ بَعِدْ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ خَطَايَايَ كَمَا بَعَدْتَ بَيْنَ الْمِسْرِ الْمَقْرِبِ, etc. So there is more than one form in dua al-istiftah. Also there is more than one form in dua al-ruku'. Sometimes say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. Sometimes Subhana Rabbi al-Azim wa bihamdihi. Sometimes say Subbuh Quddus Rabbul Malaikat wa Ruh. So also for the tahiyyat there are more than one forms, and the wisdom behind this. So our salah will not be, as we always mention and repeat, it will not come as a routine. So when the person know that every time he will choose one form, this will make him think about what he is going to say while he's sitting, while he's prostrating, while he's bowing, or while standing, will think. But if the person just keep one form, repeat it, then it will become, automatically he will say it as a routine. And this is why some people, when they pray, their lips moving, and they don't know what they say because they get used to this. Na'am. Na'am. Other questions? Any other questions, brothers? If there are none, then we'll conclude our class. Jazakumullah khair. Barakallah feekum. For brothers and sisters who are following in the Facebook, you can please post your questions in the comments, and inshallah we'll reply for it. Jazakumullah khair. Barakallah feekum. Okay, so we'll conclude. We'll end our class. See you inshallah next week. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in the knowledge of the deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us and all Muslim our good deeds. May Allah preserve Muslim wherever they are. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep and preserve Muslim and all the whole world from this pandemic. And we get rid of it inshallah and return to our normal life. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu sallam wa baraka ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.